This wonderful time of encounters with the Holy Spirit. Just understand that for you to be a reference point on earth, you must have encountered a lot of references. That is the way it works. Any genuine encounter with the Holy Spirit matriculates your life to a new level. And that's all you need, because when you're stagnated in life, you begin to decay. And when you begin to decay, you begin to attract all manners of flies and rubbish to your life. Man is meant to grow. You just have to grow. Any day you stop learning, you start dying. So we learn to grow. That is the way it works. In Luke chapter 21, verse 38, the Bible says, they woke up early in the morning. All of them, they went to Jesus. That's number one. Number two, to hear him. Why to hear him? To so that they can matriculate their mental cavity, you know, to the realities of heaven. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 8 and verse 9 says, God's thoughts and God's ways are higher than that of man, as the heavens are higher than the earth. So in other words, if we want to begin to get into the thoughts of God, we need to get to the love letter that God has given to man. The thought of God is in his word, the Bible. And when we go into it and begin to glean into the word that is there, our mind will begin to be brainwashed. You know, we'll begin to renew our minds, as in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. He said, by the renewing of our mind, so that we'll not conform to the world, so that we'll be transformed to the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. So that same mind that is in him will be in us. In any case, you must get this clear. Where the mind goes, the man goes. That's why I'm bringing to you today cut off branches. It's important for you to know that anytime you start having fellowship with God, then something happens to you. Because 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 33 says, evil communication corrupts good manners. So whosoever you work with, you relate with, determines how your life will be impacted, positively or negatively. That's the way it happens. So when you fellowship with God's word, fellowship with the Holy Spirit, you have genuine encounters. It's not just listening to me. It's just not listening to preachings and teachings. It's for you to have fellowship with the word that is coming out. I have a covenant with God. He said, as I speak, I see. That's the way it is. So as you're listening, prophetic words will be coming to you from these lips of clay. And make sure you don't joke with them. One short thing I want to let you know, number one, is that every prophetic word, prophetic utterance, prophetic declaration can never be brought to fulfillment by energy of the flesh. No, not by man's organization. No, not by man's plan. No. It is by the energy of God. That's the way it was. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 9. It said, by strength of man, you cannot prevail. Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6. It said, it's not by power, it's not by might, it's by the Holy Spirit. So no matter how much we try, it is good to make efforts. But result is the issue. And it's the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, that helps us. John chapter 15, verse 5. He said, without me, you can do nothing. In other words, when we are cut off from God, when we are a branch that is cut off from him, we will work. We will work hard, but will not be refreshed. We will not get the maximum result, the maximum output we are supposed to get by our input. The reason is this. John chapter 3, verse 27. He said, a man can receive nothing except it be given him by God. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7 says something wonderful. Paul looked at everything. He said, is there anything you have that God didn't give to you? In other words, when we have God at the center of our mind and we acknowledge him in all that we do, bring him to bear and partner with him, then we begin to get greater results. That's the way it works. Fruits, results, impacts. That's what life is all about. Because your life must impact somebody, must impact some other people. So what am I saying today? That it takes fellowship with the word of God. Acts chapter 10, verse 44. The Bible says, while Peter yet spake, he had not finished speaking. He said, the Holy Ghost came upon them that had him. That's the way it works. Because they were having fellowship. There were many people there. But the Holy Ghost did not come upon everyone. It came upon only those who had Peter. The word that was coming out of the lips of clay of Peter. Every word of God is inspired by God. The Bible, every scripture is inspired by God. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. So you must understand that. Ezekiel chapter 2, verse 2. He said, while he yet spake to me, the Spirit entered me. Because the word of God communicates the Spirit of God and established me, stood me on my feet. That's the way it works. Jesus says, the words I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. In other words, when you're having fellowship with the word of God, it communicates his life and his spirit to you. And it is the spirit that quickens. Romans chapter 8, verse 11. He said, if the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwelleth in you, he said, it shall quicken. That word quicken means make alive your mortal bodies. So in other words, instead of your mortal bodies to begin to die, the Holy Spirit will make a living thing out of it again. That's the way it was, but you must have an encounter with him. And the best way is to fellowship with the word of God. As you're fellowshipping with the word of God, you're fellowshipping with the Spirit of the Most High God. That's the way it works. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 8, he said, the word entered into Jacob, and it lighted up Israel. So the word entered Jacob, it made him a nation. The word entered Jacob, it lighted up his environment. That's the way it works. It's what is inside the side of you that will come out, either through your speech, your attitude, your actions, and that is who you are at the end of the day. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Proverbs chapter 23, verse 7. So there is no substitute at all to having fellowship with the word of God, if you want to make it excellently in the affairs of life, and if you want to eloquently display the Godhead on earth. So what I'm bringing to you today is that you can be on earth and jumping around, and you are a cut-off branch. That's why the topic of my message today is cut-off branches. There are many people that are there, they're already cut off. In Luke chapter 13, beginning to read from verse 7, it says, the owner of the vineyard came and said, I've come here 3 years, and this tree is occupying space. There is no fruit. There is no fruit at all. He said, cut it down. So in other words, this tree is just a cut-off tree. It's not fruitful, and God is addicted to fruitfulness. God does not want our lives in all ramifications to be stagnant and dormant. God wants our lives to be fruitful in all good works. Fruitful in our academic pursuits, fruitful in our careers, fruitful in our relational activities, fruitful in our marital destinies, fruitful spiritually, mentally, and fruitful spiritually, physically. So you get to understand this very well. So he said, cut it off. And then the man dressed and said, please allow it another 1 year, if not. So there are many branches that are cut off, but they are still jumping around. So may you not be a cut off branch. Because if you are a cut off branch, then you are on your own. You are on your own. In John chapter 15, verse 1, Jesus said, I am. Oh, this is wonderful. He said, I am the vine. My father is the husbandman. And any branch in me that does not bear fruit, my father yanks off. He cuts them off. So those are the cut-off branches. And once they are cut off, we cut off a branch, watch out. That branch will still retain some level of life, but it's already cut off. It's not receiving anything again. It's just a matter of time. You will notice if you begin, the leaves will begin to change color, will begin to drop, and will soon dry. So there are a lot of cut-off branches that are still preaching. They are still teaching. They are still doing one thing or the other. They are still making some efforts on earth, but they are cut-off branches because they are not receiving energy, positive energy from heaven again. They are not connected to God. A lot of things can disconnect you from God. You become a cut-off branch. One of them is iniquity. One of them is sin. Isaiah chapter 59, verse 1. He said, are my hands shortened that I cannot help you? But he says, your iniquities have separated you from me. So in other words, you have become a cut-off branch. You are not longer there. Anger can separate you from God. Complaining and murmuring can separate you from God. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 10. He said, don't be like them who murmured in the wilderness, and the destroyer came and destroyed them. Because of murmuring, they didn't get any assistance from God. They didn't get any help from God. They were cut off branches. Numbers, look at what happened there, Numbers 11. The Bible says, and they murmured, and God heard them. And God was displeased, and his anger was kindled. So they were not helped. And all of them that their murmured died in the wilderness, except Joshua and Caleb. So when you're a cut-off branch, then you find out that you are not connected to God again. And I pray that today is a day of rededication for you, a day of reconciliation with God. We have the ministry of reconciliation, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, from 17 to 20. That's why the Bible calls us ambassadors of Christ, reconciling men to God. I pray that today, if you are a cut-off branch, you can get back. That John chapter 15, verse 1, he said, the branch that does not bear fruit, my Father cuts them off. Listen, it now says, the ones that bear fruit, my Father makes them fit. He purges them so that they can bear much fruit. In other words, whatever is making them unfruitful, he removes them. Just understand, there is a sharp difference between barrenness and unfruitfulness. Barrenness means that the capacity to bear fruit is no longer there. The ability to bear fruit is no longer there. But unfruitfulness means the ability is there, the capacity is there. But for one reason or the other, maybe laziness, laxity, or whatever, the person is not bearing fruit. And that really dishonors God. God wants us to be fruitful in all good works. You are in school, you have to go for excellence. You can determine your first class status from day one you enter school. That's what God wants. You don't follow vain people. People that are unproductive, you don't follow them. You yank them off your life. Follow people who will challenge you to do the right things. That's the truth. Who you follow determines what follows you. That's the way it works. You begin to check your relationships, audit your relationships, audit the programs you watch, audit the books you read, so that your thoughts could have some quality. Please understand this very well, that once you don't bear fruit, God cuts you off. He gives you a time, and you continue like that. But the ones that bear fruit, he prunes them, he purges them, he separates them from wasters and destroyers so that they can bear more fruit. God is interested in fruit. Let me show you something. Let me give you an analysis or a case study. Isaiah for today. Look at Isaiah. We call Isaiah eagle-eyed prophet, somebody who prophesied, who lived in our day. He talked as if he was living in the day of Jesus in our day. He said, unto us, a child is born. And unto us, a son is given. He wasn't saying it in the futuristic sense. He was almost living in that reality. A good-eyed prophet. Check all his prophecies. But it was not so from the beginning. In Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah had a human insulation called King Uzziah. Isaiah left his own beat and became a palace prophet. He was a cut-off branch. Isaiah chapter 6 verse 1 says, in the year King Uzziah died, Isaiah testifying, he said, I saw the Lord. The question is, he didn't know the God he was prophesying for. He was the mouthpiece, the spokesman for in the palace. He was going for the people in the high places. He was going for the lookers of the earth. He was going for the mundane things to be known in the palaces, but he lost connection with God. And he said, look at him, testifying. I believe you come to that point today. When you now saw the Lord, when you have a genuine encounter with the Holy Spirit, you see yourself for who you are. Those pretenses, hypocrisies will no longer be there again. If you are real to yourself, it calls for change. He now said, I am a man. He said first, he said, I am undone. Hi, that is, I was doing something I was not prepared for. Jesus was prepared for 30 years before he went into 3 years earthly ministry. Isaiah just jumped in and he was a cut-off bride. He said, I am undone, which means I am not really prepared for what I've been doing. I've been showcasing myself and not God. He said, I'm undone. Two, he said, I am a man of unclean lips. Three, and I am in the midst of a people of unclean lips. Can you see that? Because you attract people like you to yourself. That's the way it works. So instead of his mouth giving the genuine prophetic utterances and declarations of God, he was a lying lips. And then he cried out. Something happened. An angel brought a coal of fire, touched his lips, and his tongue was healed that day. But look at the big bomb. While he was running around, heaven has declared his position vacant. It was then he was able to hear that heaven was shopping for another person to occupy him. Heaven was shouting, whom shall we send? Who will go for us? Hey, he had it. He thought before he was the one sent, but he was not. He was a cut-off branch. So most of us can be running around now, preaching, teaching, or doing one thing or the other in all our phases of life. You can be a secular teacher, a banker, but who sent you there? That's the point. You can be a cut-off branch like Isaiah. While God is shopping for another person, there are many stones in the fire. Jesus says, I'll raise stones to praise me if you cannot. He now had it, and he shouted, here am I, send me, send me. Give me another chance. And then heaven gave him another chance. And today he is more important, more impactful to the living than some of the living. That's the way it works. Some people are dead, but they are more impactful today than those who are living. So are you a cut-off branch? If you get to 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 40, you see the lamentation there. He said, a man was given to me to keep. But while I was going here and there, that is cut off branches, no focus, here and there. Matthew chapter 6, verse 22, he said, the eye is the light of the body. And if your eye be single, your whole body shall be full of light. In other words, focus. The fastest way to destroy any man, any person, is a broken focus. Give the person another focus, and the person will be running here and there, dissipating energy, and will not get to any reasonable place or thing. Now here, he said, the man that was given to me, I lost it. That is, I lost my beat, cut off branch. And he said, you have said it yourself, because you have lost him, your life for him. I pray that will not be you in the name of Jesus. I pray today you get back to God. I pray today you reconcile with God. There are many cut-off branches, but your spirit will bear you witness whether you're still with him. You can't be in the kingdom. You are singing in the choir. God has given you a good job in a place, and then you are using the job to insult him. You are preaching. You are there. You are doing one thing or the other, and you are walloping in sin. You are insulting God. You are a cut-off branch. You can be preaching, you can be teaching. But as far as you are walloping in sin, you are a cut-off branch. He said, Do we continue in sin that grace may abound? He said, God forbid. Grace is the power over sin. Power over sin. Are you there? God has opened the door for you. You are using it to cheat. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 11. See, if you take that which is not yours, you will die and leave that in, and then your end will be the end of shame. If you take what God has not given you, God will take what he has given you. That's the way it works. Oh, yeah. Esau went and took the porridge. God took the birthright. Adam took the fruits. God said he shouldn't take. God took the garden. Beloved, are you a cut off branch? You better repent today and get back to the vine and receive new strength to survive. Beloved, the beginning of miracles for any human being is to give his or her life to Christ, to be in the family of God, to live a holy life and be certain that if rapture happens or if you die, you will make heaven. Many people are dead. They didn't plan to die at that time. They had plans, but some slept, didn't wake up. A lot of things have taken many lives, but the issue is only those who are dead know where they are. Title cannot save you. What saves you is Jesus and being on the same page with him. Amos chapter 3 verse 3 says, can two walk together except they be agreed? That is the point. If you want to be on the same page with God, to spend eternity with him, he said, be you holy as I am holy. You must make that your foundation. Matthew chapter 1 verse 21, the foundation of Jesus. He said, he shall come to save men from their sins. That is to remove that sin nature. That is what it is. That's the foundation. Holiness is profitable unto all things. Beloved, I want to give you a chance today to say, Lord Jesus, I return back to you. And I want to walk with you. Don't allow the devil to blind your eyes to the reality of being on the same page with God. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. He said, whom the God of this world has blinded, that seeing they will not see. I pray the blindness of the devil over your life will clear off now. I damage every form of ignorance in your life. That's the way it works. Ignorance is a deadly thing. Isaiah chapter 5 verse 13. You see, great men are impoverished. They're in bondage because of ignorance. Look at the lamentation in Hosea chapter 4 verse 6. He said, my own people. He said, they perish for lack of knowledge. Job chapter 13 verses 1 and 2. He said, I know what you know, therefore I'm no longer inferior to you. So that is where ignorance makes you an inferior person in the affairs of life. That's where quest for requisite knowledge, profitable knowledge, is something you don't have to compromise. You must know God. Daniel chapter 11 verse 32. He said, those that know their God, they shall be strong and they shall do exploits. Conversely, those that do not know their God, they shall be weak and they shall be exploited. Cut off branches are those that don't know their God. They are not having fellowship with their God. Beloved, return to God. You give your life to Christ. Submit to him. It is just your choice. The choice you make today makes you tomorrow. Deuteronomy chapter 30 verse 19. Is I present unto you today life and death, but I counsel you to choose life, that it may be well with you and your children. Since your choice, life is a choice and not a chance. The choice you make today makes you tomorrow. So make that choice today. Come into the family. And you that went out of the family, come back. God is waiting for you. It's you that moved. God has been the same. Malachi 3:6. He says, I am God. I change not. He has been there waiting for you. Son, come back. You cut off branch, come back. And then life will come to you again. Beloved, I pray today will be that day that you will never forget him ever in your life. Remember, it is loving God. Remember, it is loving people. Remember, it is touching lives positively and serving our God. I am Fresh Fire. We are missionaries on assignment to connect the whole world with his love and his presence. Thank you. And as I come your way tomorrow, please remember, don't be a cut-off branch. Get back to God. Thank you for listening.
Hello there. Are you worshiping with us for the first time? Congratulations. You are most welcome into this great gathering. This is no coincidence. We believe that your steps were ordered by God and he has a plan for you. You are now a candidate of God's revival. We are a generation called to worship the one true God. We do this in spirit and in truth, in kindness and in love, preaching and teaching the word of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. Here, your mind will be renewed as we connect you to God's presence, and you are now transformed into a giant of a strange order. Welcome home.